All right. Well, Trump approved Republican Glenn Youngkin's closing message to Virginia voters has almost singularly focused on weaponizing race, stoking hysteria over the coded boogeyman of critical race theory, which is not currently taught in any Virginia public school. From promoting banning Toni Morrison's Beloved, this epic novel, a Pulitzer Prize winning seminal work of American fiction that recounts the horrors of slavery, to casting himself as the candidate of so-called parents' rights, vowing to ban critical race theory, which again is not taught if elected. Again, it's not taught in any Virginia public schools. With us now is Cornell Belcher, Democratic pollster and MSNBC political analyst, who's also a Virginia native. And Cornell, I asked this question of Julian Castro earlier, and I will ask it of you now. What lessons, if in fact the results that we see right now prevail and Glenn Youngkin becomes the next governor of Virginia, what lessons should Democrats take from it, and what lessons do you think Republicans will take from it?
Well, a couple of things, Joy, and it is one, and I said this earlier, you know, even more so than Youngkin versus Terry McAuliffe, I think Trumpism and critical race theory is on the ballot. And what you're seeing, whether Terry, and there's still a lot of votes out, but whether or not Terry makes this up or not, I think tonight is a victory for critical race theory. Because if you look at McAuliffe, and again, it's still early, it's not a lot of votes out, but if you look at McAuliffe's margins, so they're way off of what Biden's margins are. And in a place like Loudoun, Biden won that by, what, close to 20 points. You know, he's only winning it by 10. You know, Virginia Beach, a really sort of critical swing area that swung for Biden, you know, that is now too close to call. Wherever you look, it looks like these college-educated suburban white voters who Democrats thought were breaking their way, you know, they rallied back around critical race theory. And again, you know, for me, critical race theory, Joy, is just the most recent, more eloquent iteration of the Southern strategy, right? Whether it be crosstown busing, whether it be the welfare queen, whether it be defund the police. This original sin of America keeps evolving, and critical race theory is the most latest and most eloquent, quite frankly, iteration of the Southern strategy in a way, quite frankly, to tribalize an election, to tribalize an electorate in a way to drive up the white vote. And whether Terry comes back or not, I think that critical race theory was center to Youngkin's sort of close here, and that he's made it so close. And a lot of these suburban areas where Democrats thought they were making ground in, I think we're going to see this again in the midterm, and it's going to be problematic.
Yeah, and let me bring in Jason Johnson. I think we have his camera up there. Jason Johnson, to that very point, yeah. Christopher Rufo did a speech at the Claremont Institute, and he's one of the people who's been the most eager and active in pushing Republicans to use this as a strategy to turn out their vote and to pull in suburban voters. And he admitted at the Claremont Institute that he had no idea what critical race theory is and doesn't care what it is, but that whenever he what he wants is that when white voters see any story that makes them uncomfortable, anything that's about wokeism or, you know, multiculturalism that makes them mad, he wants them to think critical race theory and then vote Republican. It's a strategy that they were not hiding. It's been very open, and the Claremont Institute and others, they've been very open about it. What does it say to you that Glenn Youngkin was able to, we don't know how this is going to turn out, we should go say again, it's too close to call, but if Youngkin wins based on using that strategy, is Cornell right? This is the new Lee Atwater strategy, and it's going to be used over and over and over again.
I rarely disagree with Cornell on air. I gotta disagree with him on this. Look, here, the only reason that we're talking about critical race theory is because Glenn Youngkin had 18 months to convince people that he was not a fire-breathing, horns out of his skull racist. You can only talk about critical race theory if you present yourself as the kind of neutral white guy who's like, I don't dislike brown people. I just think this is going a little too far. So it only works if you've been able to present yourself as neutral or non-hostile on race issues. That's not something that a lot of Republicans are very good at. And I saw somebody put this very eloquently online. They said, look, you know, Glenn Youngkin ran pretending to be Larry Hogan. He's going to govern like Mike DeWine. But to his base, they think he's Ron DeSantis. And that's what this is. It was a very sneaky triangulation. Because if you run on critical race theory and you're a screaming MAGA hat wearing maniac, then you're going to lose those suburban people because they don't want to be associated with that.
Right.
So I think it's only an effective strategy if you've been able to put four or five, six other things in line. Anybody else who runs on critical race theory, if you don't have the proper candidate to promote the message, it's not going to get you anywhere.